program for the performing arts. Crescendo is a production of international artists in New York City and Seattle, Washington. Thank you for joining us.
This week on Crescendo, we have a special treat for you. We're going to go back in time to Gloucester, Massachusetts, to the Hammond Castle, to a time when Mark Andersen was the resident artist at the Hammond Castle on the largest residential pipe organ in the world. We will hear Mark playing this wonderful pipe organ, and we'll also hear Mark talk about John Hayes Hammond Jr., who was an inventor and an organ enthusiast.
Well, my early background in music goes back quite a ways. I was born in North Carolina. My grandmother was a concert pianist, and I started learning to play Bach when I was just barely 3 years old. By the time I was six, she had me in state piano teacher competitions playing Bach two-part inventions. From there, I went to the regular course of school, grammar school, and high school, studying music all the way, and I won a scholarship to study with Marcel Dupré at the Paris Conservatory. And actually, the way I initially met Marcel Dupré was by the great graces of John Hayes Hammond, Jr.
Tell us a little bit about that meeting.
Interesting meeting. I had played a concert in Durham, North Carolina, when I was just barely 14 years old, on the Duke Chapel organ. And as it happened, John Hayes Hammond was at that program and heard me, met me afterwards, and invited me to come to Gloucester, Massachusetts, which was a place at that time I'd never even heard of. But I was so intrigued by the sounds of the pipe organ that he was telling me about that he had in his home, which he didn't tell me very much about, but I got the feeling had quite a mystique about it, that I talked my parents into a trip that summer, and I walked in these halls for the first time at that tender age, and first found the glorious pipe organ here, perched high on a loft on the side wall of the Great Hall.
And did you envision this organ to be as grand as it turned out to be?
At that particular time, the largest thing in an organ that I had encountered was a local organ in our Baptist church in Lumberton, North Carolina. And I just had no scope of what this could be. Of course, the organ at Duke Chapel was a huge instrument that I had just encountered that weekend, but I still had no idea that someone could actually have a pipe organ this size in a residence. Of course, I wasn't exactly ready for a residence like this either.
Tell us about some of the other things that impressed you about John Hayes Hammond, Jr.
The man's gentleness, the overpowering sensitivity, the magnificent scope of his mind. His mind was always 15 steps ahead of anything that you could say. He could complete a sentence for you before you even got the thought finished. And it was so obvious that you were in the presence of a brilliant, sensitive individual.
Thank you.
How did Dr. Hammond introduce you to the instrument?
He took me on a tour of the pipe organ and a tour of the towers and the private museums in the back where there are still artifacts that a lot of the public doesn't get to see. And needless to say, I was awe-stricken, speechless.
And did you have many opportunities to play the organ after that?
Well, after that, I began playing, coming to the castle fairly frequently and playing a few programs. And then on one of the trips here, I met Marcel Dupre, who was here at the time. He, of course, was a very close friend of Dr. Hammond's. And that meeting actually ended with my applying for a scholarship and winning that scholarship to study at the Paris Conservatory with Marcel Dupre. Of course, in the meantime, John Hayes Hammond had passed away. I moved back to Boston to do some work with the Boston Symphony and the Boston Pops in the early 70s, and came back to the castle, met the current curator of the museum at that time, and made arrangements along with the organists who were in residence here at that time to start doing some programs. And I did a whole series of concerts back in the early 70s. My career then took me on the road and I moved to New York, and it has been about an 18-year gap when I finally came back to the Boston area. And when I did move back to Boston, one of the first places that I came was back to the Hammond Castle and, of course, met John Pettibone.
And has the organ changed a lot during the years of your absence?
Well, of course, the new console, the mechanism that we have here, is far, far in advance of the console that was on the instrument at the time that I was playing it before. However, this new console is certainly nothing that John Hayes Hammond himself would not have done. As a matter of fact, I think as advanced and as wonderful all the computer features are that we have here, and the things that are on no other pipe organ in the whole world, I would imagine if he were still alive, there would be even more.
So what you're saying is Dr. Hammond was always innovating and continually improving the pipe organ.
There were additions made to the instrument from 1930s all the way through the 60s. And at present, we're endeavoring to continue that.
And what were his views on the pipe organ and its versatility?
Well, of course, he very frequently quoted Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart in saying that the organ was the king of instruments. And it indeed was the king of instruments to him. It was a passion with him. Of course, he himself was not a musician. His playing was limited to just holding a few notes and listening to the magnificently beautiful sounds, which he loved. But he had a passion for the instrument, for the mechanism of the instrument, for the music, the musicality, the capabilities of the instrument that way. And some of the things on this instrument show forth his almost intuitive knowledge of music, even though he himself was not a performing musician.
Thank you.
I understand that the original console had some tab stops with Dr. Hammond's initials on them. Tell us about those.
Well, that means basically the stop tablets were his own creation. These were special favorite things of his, and some of these were sounds that he actually developed by making combinations of different sounds that were already in existence.
Pretty impressive. So which of his inventions and innovations that Dr. Hammond made are still in use today on pipe organs?
Well, of course, many of the mechanical features that we have on modern pipe organs are directly related to him, and many of the compositions that we have, for instance, the Fantasy in F sharp that I won the International Composers Competition with, was a direct result of my contact at an early age with this pipe organ and his inventive personality.
So referring back to your own innovative and challenging compositions, how did Dr. Hammond influence you in that regard?
Well, I guess in some ways he was an early age hero to me, and I've patterned a lot of the things, and especially the creative forces in my life, after what I felt and saw in him.
Now, knowing John Hayes Hammond's great passion for the organ, did he ever learn to play the pipe organ himself?
Oh, he often said that he would like to play, but of course he knew that the great discipline that it would take to take the art to the level that he could accept it would be impossible along with everything else he did in his life. You have to understand that John Hayes Hammond Jr. would not have been content to learn a scale or to learn a simple church hymn. If he was going to become a musician, he would have wanted to play like Dupre.
Thank you.
enjoyed the handbell choirs and solo handbell performances on Crescendo, we certainly want to let you know about an upcoming concert, Saturday evening, February the 3rd, the new Emerald City Ringers, Seattle's newest handbell choir, will be performing at 7 p.m. at Grace Lutheran Church in Des Moines. You will hear the choir, soloist, and a lovely concert violinist as well.
Thank you for joining us on this episode of Crescendo. We hope to see you next time.